are here again to worship the Lord. Please join in our worship choruses, our praise choruses. The first is Thou Art Worthy. Worship. This is the fourth Sunday of Advent, a time to rejoice in the wondrous things that God is doing. Our hearts are filled with the hope that is coming into the world. The time is fast approaching, not for parties or presents, but for the awareness of God's loving gift to us, the gift of Christ, the Christ child. Help us slow down, Lord, that we may realize that your gift of love is at the center of our lives and our celebrations. Thanks be to God who again reminds us of God's eternal love. Open our hearts, O Lord, to receive your blessed gift. Amen. Our hymns today are a couple of carols you know, the First Noel and Thou Didst Leave Thy Throne. Please sing along.
So how great is your love for God? How great is your love for Christ? How great is your love for your neighbor? Paul describes love as the greatest attribute a Christian can have in 1 Corinthians chapter 13. Jesus tells his disciples to love God with all your heart, mind, and soul, and to love your neighbor as you love yourself in Matthew 22. He also commanded his disciples in John chapter 15 to love one another as I have loved you, saying that no one has greater love than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. It is clear that what challenges a Christian in expressing great and true love is that it requires self-sacrifice. Only the most powerful, divine, and loving God could have given us the greatest gift anyone in the world could have ever received, Jesus Christ. In Luke chapter 1, verses 36 through 38, we find another prophetic message of the birth of Jesus. However, this message about a coming Messiah stands alone from the others. Luke's account is a prophetic message to the one who will carry and nurture the coming Messiah from conception to birth, and then through adolescence. It's a prophetic message about the Savior of the world, who will enter the world through a young teenage girl who is pledged to be married to a carpenter. Let us read those verses. In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a town in Galilee called Nazareth, to a virgin engaged to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary. And he came to her and said, "Greetings, favored one, the Lord is with you." But she was much perplexed by his words and pondered what sort of greeting this might be. The angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And now you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High, and the Lord God will give to him the throne of his ancestor David. He will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end." Mary said to the angel, "How can this be, since I am a virgin?" The angel said to her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be holy. He will be called Son of God. And now your relative Elizabeth, in her old age, has also conceived a son. And this is the sixth month for her who was said to be barren. For nothing will be impossible with God." Then Mary said, "Here am I, the servant of the Lord. Let it be with me according to your word." Then the angel departed from her. Today is the fourth Sunday of Advent. Today our theme is about love, and in a usual worship service, we would have lit the candle representing love in our Advent wreath. Within this foretelling of Mary's pregnancy and the birth of Jesus, we can uncover two types of love: human love and divine or godly love. Mary and Joseph were a couple of common stature. They were actually a socially marginalized couple. They were common folk or peasants. God chose to complete his will through the humble nature and commonality of Joseph and Mary. Why? Because they were faithful and loving servants of God. However, Joseph and Mary were flawed servants simply because they were human, meaning sometimes their love for God and neighbor would break down and become weak. Joseph was a righteous man before God. He was an obedient man to God. But later, when he found out that Mary was with child, he was deeply hurt. He was hurt deeply because they had never been together in a husband-wife relationship. Mary was to be a virgin. And I'm sure he had thoughts of retaliation, thoughts of punishing her. He no doubt at first wanted to publicly humiliate her because she betrayed him. He surely was questioning his love for Mary. possibly even questioning his love for God, a love that was being challenged and stretched. But we know that Joseph is visited by an angel in a dream, and because of his love for God and Mary was so strong, he receives the truth about this child. And in direct obedience, he places himself in the realm of public humiliation, above and beyond embarrassment, by marrying a pregnant bride. Joseph's love prevailed. It was a love so great. Mary also loved God. She too was a righteous and obedient servant of God. But now she gets this message from the angel Gabriel. He says to her, "Greetings, favored one. The Lord is with you." These words catch Mary off guard, as they would anyone. What did the angel mean by this statement, Mary wondered. Then the angel adds more confusion by telling Mary, "Do not be afraid, for you have found favor with God." What favor? God favors me? And then he hits her with a 1-2 punch. He says, "You will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you will name him Jesus." Now, for all you ladies out there, I want you to put yourself in Mary's circumstance up to this point. How would you react? What would you be thinking? How would you handle this circumstance? At this news, I am sure Mary is ready to scream, "What? You have to be kidding me. I'm a virgin. God, don't do this to me. How will I ever explain this?" Mary's love for God is now under some attack. She is no doubt questioning her love for God right now, questioning her faith and ability to obey God. Doubt about God's love for Mary has been planted. Suddenly, Mary is wondering why God would do this to her. She's wondering how Joseph can continue to love her under these circumstances. How can he trust me? Mary's love for God still gave her some glimmer of faith, because after the angel tells her about Elizabeth's maternity news, she says to the angel, "Let it be with me according to your word." However, as many, if not all of us, have discovered, these words are easier said than done. Mary no doubt struggles to live out those words, so she quickly travels to visit her relative, Elizabeth, to confirm what the angel had told her. And it wasn't until after this visit with Elizabeth that she could finally express her joy and praise in a song. It's called Mary's Song of Praise in verses 46 through 55. Mary's love prevailed. It was a love so great. In this passage, Mary's love for God was tested. Her love for Joseph was tested. But what about God's love for Mary? What about God's love for humanity? God's love, as we know, is unconditional. God's love for us is not dependent on our love for Him, nor our good or bad deeds. God loves us greater than we could ever love one another, a living thing, or an object or activity. His love for us lasts forever and cannot be diminished. And we are affirmed this by the birth story of Jesus. Christmas Day should remind us every year how much God loved the world. God's love for humanity was demonstrated by His willingness to fulfill His salvation plan by choosing Mary to be the surrogate mother of his son. Mary's virginity, faith, and obedient service to God provided a reverent, divine, and honorable pathway for the birth of Jesus into a world that is full of sin. It wasn't that God needed Mary for this birth, but that God loved humanity so greatly that he honored Mary with the task of nurturing and raising his son. God demonstrated his love for humanity when he shared the same love through Elizabeth's pregnancy, sending a prophet to prepare the way for Jesus. God's love for humanity, for the entire world, was expressed in the birth story of his son Jesus. His love was demonstrated to the world by his selfless giving of himself, by sending his son to this earth through the humbleness and solemnness of a virgin teenage girl. His love for humanity was affirmed when he fulfills his plan for the salvation of the world by sending his son to be conceived within a human and born through human means. God's love for humanity was affirmed much later when his one and only son would go to the cross to offer the world salvation from sin. And God's love for humanity will be affirmed again when his son returns and calls all his faithful believers to heaven to be with him. God's love will prevail, a love so great. In five more days, we will once again celebrate the birth of our Savior, Jesus Christ. As we prepare and wait for the birth of Jesus this Advent season, let us also prepare and wait hopefully, peacefully, joyfully, and lovingly for the return of Jesus. Pray with me. Dear God, soon your son will be born. As we enter into the final week of preparation and waiting, having to endure so much this year, may we not lose hope. May we have peace. May our joy abound. And may we have love in our hearts this Christmas. O come Emmanuel. Come, Lord Jesus, and bless us with your presence and deliver us from the trouble and pain of this world. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Please join us in singing Away in a Manger.
Down.
And now let us receive the benediction. Let us go into the world with love in our hearts. May we love others as you have loved us. May the love of Christ be transfused to those who live among us. Amen.